This lecture very much builds on the last lecture, where we looked at eugenics, particularly in that critical period that involved the development of genetic model that somehow for a while surpasses Darwinism. Now, the reason I ask this question, who makes the Nazis, is quite simple. It's because a lot of people will maintain that it was Darwin that made the Nazis, that somehow Darwin and Darwinism is responsible for the horrors of the 1930s and the 1940s. And in this lecture, what I'm going to try and do is demonstrate that while there are quite clearly elements of Nazi thinking that were tied up with elements of Darwinian thinking, it is far too simplistic to make the kind of argument that, for example, creationists make, that Hitler was all the fault of Darwin, and therefore we can discredit Darwinism. On top of that, the other thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to explore the work of Richard Weikart. And this is important because Weikart, as we will see, argues that Darwinism itself destabilizes morality. By getting rid of God, we somehow got rid of morality. By making everything material, there is nothing to ground morality in. And of course, those of you that have read The God Delusion will recognize that that is an argument that Richard Dawkins attacks with some force, it has to be said. But it's important that we take on board what Weikart says and see how people have reacted to his message, given his background, of which I will say nothing until we get to that part of the lecture. I'm also aware that while a lot of you will have done Hitler and the Nazis at school, that it's good for me to give you a bit of backstory. So I'm going to have to do a bit of the kind of history of how Hitler came to power. Before we do that, ask the question, who'd be a Hitler? This was a little grab I took off the Daily Telegraph in the UK, or the publication that those of us don't read the Daily Telegraph, we call it the Daily Torygraph, for its political sensibilities. They always like a bit of shock and horror and scandal. This was grabbed in 2009, and it was a story about Adolf Hitler's relatives who have been found in the US and Australia. And surprise, surprise, most of them have changed their names. Actually, I think all of them have changed their names. If you manage to get hold of this, what you'll find is down at the bottom, one of Hitler's descendants made the decision to get a vasectomy to ensure that his genes would not pass on. Now, we might argue that there was a genetic cause to what Hitler did. Maybe there was. I'm not sure. I think a lot of what I'll look at here is going to be firmly located in the social. But who would be a Hitler? What was that? They grabbed the report from the Daily Express, which is even worse. But some of their names, Hiedler, Hertler, most of them probably don't know of their relationship. So, such is the nature of Hitler's evil that we do everything we can to distance ourselves from him. Now, as usual, if you download or look at the slides, you'll see what I expect you to learn in this lecture, but I've kind of talked about that already. You can go to the content reviews. The one slide I'd like to draw your attention to here is this one on the reading. It's more extended than the reading that you'll find on the LMS, and you might want to refer to this if you decide to dig into Richard Weikart's career in any more detail. So that's a bit of extended reading for you. But I think as well that we should keep in mind that ultimately what we're talking about is this. the piles of bodies that were found emaciated and abused when the concentration camps were liberated in April, May 1945. And the Allies, although they'd had an inkling about this, they had knowledge that it was going on, were first confronted with the full horror of what was Hitler's final solution. I think what we see in this picture is angry Allied troops have pulled in a lot of the locals from around this particular camp, and they made them come in and witness what had occurred in the camp. It was quite a common process during this liberation period. And as we will see, this was firmly predicated on the eugenics spilling into euthanasia idea. There were certain categories of people, according to their race, or their sexual orientation, or their mental capacity, or rather incapacity, who were basically, as the Nazis put it, life unworthy of life, or life unworthy of living. So we have to keep this firmly in mind. And of course, as well, focusing on the big question, to what extent was the Nazi extermination of these different groups the product of social Darwinistic thought? Okay, well, let's kick off with how the Nazis got there. It's a long and convoluted process that goes right the way back to that war that at the time was called the Great War, the War of 1914-1919, although hostilities ceased in 1918, that we now tend to refer to as World War I, the war that Gallipoli occurred in. But the war at the time was called the Great War, or what they hoped it was going to be, the war to end all wars. Now, by 1918, Germany was in an absolutely parlous state. They were, despite, in effect, beating the Russians, they were encircled on virtually all fronts. They were blockaded. They couldn't get food in. People were starving. On top of which, the United States had entered the war in 1917, and had just sent a million soldiers to the Western Front. Germany is incredibly weak and getting weaker. One last throw of the dice in spring 1918. Germany throws everything it can into an attack on the Western Front, where they try to knock out the Allies in one single blow. And at first it seems that it succeeded. It's the most open warfare that there's been in about 3.5 years, and they get to within about 50 or 60 kilometers of Paris. That was how bad it got. At which point, the British, the Australians, the Canadians, and the Americans in particular, not the French, their army was pretty broken by this thing, beaten back and eventually, in effect, not annihilated the army, German army, but the German army was in no condition to fight anymore. And by November, it was all quiet on the Western Front. An armistice was signed that sealed off the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month of 1918. Remembrance Day in Europe, that's the one they remember in Europe rather than in Italy. And all hostilities ceased. Lots of celebrations in the countries that won, and then followed by the attempt to create a new peace. And this is absolutely critical in the rise of the Nazis. So, you know, you can start joining the dots here. People might argue about the social Darwinian element of Nazi thought, but they might as well want to pay attention to the political circumstances in which the Nazis rose, which had very little, nothing to do with Darwin. Well, we can't really look past Versailles, which was signed in 1919. It was a treaty, a peace treaty, that absolutely and totally humiliated Germany. Germany had to, I'll see if it's in the next slide, we might as well look at it if it's there. In the political sense, they're told to remove their monarch, he has to go. Wilhelm II I have to say, one of the more intriguing characters of history, a man that was, for entertainment, he used to get his chief of staff to dress up in tutus and perform ballet in front of him. He had this kind of fake horse that he used to sit on a lot during meetings. Quite a lot of the time he couldn't decide whether he was British or German, being one of Victoria's grandchildren. And this seems to have created a somewhat... schizophrenic view of the world for poor old Wilhelm.
Because he hated his mother.
There was a time when he gave an interview to the Daily Telegraph in 1907, I think it was, where he said, "I feel more British than German." It didn't play very well back in Prussia, back in Berlin. Intriguing character, head of the Reich, forced to go. They just said, right, your monarch's going, you're having a new constitution, you're going to have a republic, guys, and we're deciding that. On top of which, the Rhinelands were demilitarized, a whole load of territory was taken from Germany and whacked back to France. For example, Alsace-Lorraine. What empire Germany had managed to build up during the late 19th, early 20th century was confiscated, so these territories here, quite close to them. Did Australia get to
Overseas? Yes, we took over the mandate. Yeah,
took over the mandate of that part of Papua New Guinea. You can see the tracts of Africa that were confiscated from Germany. And then the Germans were told, well, you can't have a military, you can't have an army, you can't have a navy, you can have a defence force. But that's it. No air force. Everything is going to be restricted. And then on top of this, they had to accept this clause in the treaty that firmly laid the blame for the war on Germany. They had to accept the war guilt clause, which again is a pretty humiliating thing to do. And then they were told that they had to pay $25 billion as a punishment for going to war. Compare this with what happened after the Second World War, where Germany's economy was rebuilt by the Americans, and where Japan's economy was rebuilt as well. And there is a reason for this. The reason was that politically, this was an absolute disaster of the highest order. This was the thing that really fed into the rise of extremism in Germany and the collapse of the new political settlement. Germany's humiliated politically, culturally, and economically, and the country just cannot deal with it. And so after the Second World War, they'd learnt their lesson. Japan and Germany were rebuilt at the cost of the Americans. So after Versailles, we see economic instability. Well, yeah, I don't know. Have we got any stamp collectors in the house that collected stamps when they were kids at all? No, not a sad. Oh, did you? Did you ever have any of these German ones? I mean, that's a note. But you could get like one million mark German stamps because that was how much... I think there's a... Do I have a picture of it here? Yeah, there we go. It was actually cheaper to burn the money than it was to buy wood with the money. That was how serious the inflation had got there. Instability. And then on top of that, this incredible political instability. The republic that was set up was a very interestingly designed political experiment in democracy. But its basis in proportional representation in particular did nothing to undermine the extremism that was growing on the back of this. An extremism that you could see in the discharged soldiers forming their own paramilitary groups like the Freikorps. And over this period, there were a number of battles. I don't know if anyone's seen the film Cabaret or the musical Cabaret, which is set very much during this period, where we see this battle going on between the left and right, between the emergent fascist movement and the communists, trying to battle for the soul and the political power in Germany, that led to this kind of fighting in the streets, the Spartacist insurrection, the rise of the right-wing paramilitaries, and a very, very polarised political situation. And it was in this context that we see the rise of the Nazis, of an extreme nationalist movement that wants to restore Germany to not only its former glory, but a greater glory. And there we see one of the rallies with the insignia, all the things that we associate with it. Now, this guy Hitler, this is probably my favourite picture of Hitler. It tells a whole story in it. He was born in Vienna in Austria, in the, what was then the Austro-Hungarian Empire, which was not part of Germany, but it was part of greater German culture. He was, his, I'm not sure what had happened to his father, and he ran off, or his
mother died, whatever.
Died,
remarried.
And here we have Adolf Hitler and Ludwig Wittgenstein. Wittgenstein, the great philosopher, who didn't wait around to see Hitler get to his most powerful decamp to the UK, because it wasn't a good place to be for people like Wittgenstein. One of the things that I find most intriguing about Hitler, apart from the fact that he was even lazier than George W. Bush, which is really lazy, he was Hitler was incredibly indolent. I mean, he couldn't get out of bed before about 2 o'clock in the afternoon. It's a miracle that he was able to control this web of power. But the other thing was that he had this kind of romantic streak, this romantic desire and belief in art. And nobody recognised his genius. He was a thwarted artist. It didn't help that he was bone idle and couldn't get out of bed. But what seems to have transformed Hitler was his experience during the First World War. I mean, the stories we get of the First World War are pretty damn gruesome. You know, you wouldn't get in a time machine and travel back to the Western Front, for example, to see what was going on. It was a pretty horrible place. And people wrote poetry about how horrible it was. But some people did actually enjoy the war. And Hitler was one of them. He had a good war. It snapped him out of himself. And then, when Germany was defeated, he took it personally. And this was very much what spurred him into political action. Very rapidly, he comes up to head his own political party. He's involved in constructing his own paramilitary organization, the Sturmabteilung. And in 1923, he was the leader of an attempted coup against the Weimar Republic in Munich called the Bierhall Putsch. This was an act of treason, make no mistake about it. This is the sort of thing that even if you do today in a lot of countries, you'll probably end up paying for your life. And certainly the Weimar Republic could have punished him, they could have locked him up for his life, they could have executed him for treason, but that was not what happened. He got I forgot what the term was, but he only ended up serving 12 months in prison for this act of treason. And he spent his time constructively in prison, writing his famous work, Mein Kampf, My Struggle, or this French edition, Mon Combat, where he pretty much laid out his ideas about the world, how the world operated. And when he came out, through political manipulation, he was basically able to head up a political organisation that promoted National Socialism and started exploiting the weaknesses that were apparent in the Weimar Republic. And what then, for want of a better word, and this has been debated, people have often said that Hitler came to power democratically, This is actually questionable. One has to ask whether democracy can work in an atmosphere of fear, particularly when the brown shirt thugs are walking around the polling booths and that kind of thing. On top of which, there was this extraordinary event where the Reichstag caught fire. Almost certainly it was done by Hitler's mob, but it gave the opportunity to blame the communists, who, you know, there's a kind of, you know, there's almost an equal balance at this time between the nationalists and the communists. It's not apparent who's going to win, and if they can knock the communists out of the picture, make the party completely illegal, clamp down on its membership, institute some form of one-party rule, then that's what they're going to do. And that is essentially what they did. The communists were blamed by Hitler. He urges Hindenburg to pass emergency decree suppressing the KPD. And in the election that followed, the Nazis were basically victorious, and we see the demise of the Weimar Republic. Now, as I say, you could regard this process as democratic, but I think the fact of the matter is the level of fear, the level of manipulation, means that this is not a place where democracy could function. And basically, the Nazis grabbed power on 40% of the vote. I guess Margaret Thatcher kind of did about the same. British politics was split at the time, but there you go. From then on, Europe's on a downward slide to war and genocide. Now, I think it's worth pointing out that the programme was in place as early as 1920, in place and very much on the back of Hitler's idea. And we can see the kind of programme, parts of the 25-point programme, that get incorporated into the Nazi movement. Things like only members of the German race could be citizens, no Jew can be a member of a race, struggle without consideration against those whose activity is injurious to the general interest. The state is to care for the elevating national health by protecting the mother and child. So we can already see here a number of measures that could be regarded as eugenic, particularly in regards to the way that race is being constructed. These measures are all for good German Aryan stock. Anyone that doesn't come from that is going to be excluded from it. And then all of these things, including physical fitness and sport and gymnastics, are going to become crucially important in building the right kind of German body. It's a highly eugenic program. And then, again, I think there can be no doubt that there are strong elements of social Darwinian thought behind this program and in the way that Hitler was thinking. And you can just have a look at this full quote, but the highlights in red give you some indications of the eugenic elements of it. Fox is always a fox, the goose a goose, that's profound. But you'll never find a fox who in his inner attitude might, for example, show humanitarian tendencies towards geese. As similarly, there is no cat with a friendly inclination toward mice. This view, you can see, carried over into 1942. Although here, what we see are some of the complexities. Because as the more astute of you will realise, one of the problems with war and eugenics is that there is what might be regarded as a negative selection effect, in that the best, the strongest, the fittest are the ones that are most likely to get killed and therefore drag down the race. And even Hitler was aware of these problems, and that there had to be something done to actually counter these problems. So let's have a look at how this emerged, this combination of politics, power, and eugenic science emerge into policy, into action. From the mid-1930s onwards, Germany made systematic attempts to rid itself of this category that they called life unworthy of life. The individuals, and we can see the kind of representations that they're putting forward here that were dragging Germany down economically and biologically. And initially, the targets were the disabled and the mentally ill, those kind of categories. There's just another example of the kind of propaganda. The T4 program that was carried out at places like Schloss Hartheim were the places where they developed many of the technologies of killing that were going to get carried forward into places like Auschwitz. Initially, their attempts to get rid of the elderly or the mentally ill just involved not taking care of them, starving them, letting them freeze to death, that kind of thing. But increasingly, they started experimenting with industrial methods of killing. And it was in places like this that they first tested out the use of gas to get rid of these groups that were regarded as undesirable. And then, through the 30s, Germany seeking more room, seeking more land, seeking the uniting of the German peoples, was expanding forcefully through Europe. And as they expand into places like Poland, that have very large populations of Jewish people, they're rounded up, hemmed into ghettos, walled into ghettos, where they can barely leave. And this is to prevent them mixing with the pure Aryans, but also punitive as well. And again, from an early point, others of these Jews rounded up, sent to forced labour camps, the camps that are going to become the concentration camps. Initially, these weren't the kind of factories of extermination of death that they became post-41. They were places where people died through overwork and through disease. But initially, there was no systematic attempt to exterminate a whole people. And then, as the war is taking a turn for the worse, the Nazi High Command in 1941 decide to execute, plan and execute the final solution. And here we see a pile of shoes that's the result of the extermination that occurred on the back of that. It is still deeply disturbing, still a quite horrific thing that went on there. So let's now have a look at the relationship between historians and interpreting this story, with a particular focus on the social Darwinian element of it. So, I ask this question. With all the accumulated evidence, who can doubt that social Darwinism, both through its connections with eugenics, through metaphors for struggle and competition and the survival of the most fit, through theories of race and species, and more besides, who can doubt that this contributed to the extermination of millions? Well, you know, find a group of doubters, historians, it's their job, we're natural skeptics. And there are quite a few historians that have questioned this particular trajectory. And these are the basis of the critiques that have been made. Most don't deny that there was this strand of social Darwinism in Nazi thought. But they're then wary about this thing of reading back the whole of Nazi ideology into the configuration of social Darwinism that find their origins prior to the Great War. It's a trajectory that people have been charting. A whole load of German historians. In fact, there was a movement in German historiography from about the 1960s onwards that sought to explain the Second World War in the kind of culture that emerged in Wilhelmine Germany in the pre-First World War period, and sought to explore the long continuities that are apparent from that period to the period of the 1930s. For example, the issue of anti-Semitism. It is no coincidence, for example, that the Zionist movement predominantly emerges from Jewish people in Germany. They're a very strong element of the emergence of Zionism and the search for a separate Jewish state. This is a direct reaction to the kind of treatment, the kind of discrimination that is occurring in Germany at this time. Of course, it's going on elsewhere. We only have to look at things like the Dreyfus Affair in the 1890s to see that similar things were going on in France. Nevertheless, there has been this attempt to see Nazi culture being located in that pre-First World War period. And critical to that is the way that social Darwinism is ingrained in intellectual thought in Germany. Now, the few people that will argue, though, that there is a really strong connection, that won't do what I've done and say, hey, look at all of this politics that's going on there, that's kind of interfering with. The few that do say that, you know, social Darwinism is a direct cause of the Nazis, of Hitler, and what goes on in that period, they do so by making their connection with people like Ernst Haeckel and the way that they were integral to the development of Nazi ideology. However, if we look at the case of Haeckel, a very complex, multifaceted story about social Darwinism emerges. So let's have a quick look at that before we move on to Weikart. Now, Haeckel is a big player in the Darwin story. He has been labelled, he's one of Darwin's bulldogs. Now, he's communicating with Darwin very early on. He's converted to the Darwinian universe on his first reading of Origin of Species. He's influenced by the wider trends of German philosophy and science, like naturphilosophy, but he is integral to the development of Darwinian ideas in German culture and science. And that illustration, The Pedigree of Man, is taken from one of his works. He's also the person that ontogeny recapitulates phylogeny. Do you know what that means, anyone? Any guesses? It's basically the old recapitulation argument rebranded. Can anyone remember what recapitulation was? Anyone? Go back to Saint-Hilaire recapitulation? That the development of the embryo goes through all of the evolutionary stages that the species has gone through to get to where they are today as the embryo develops. And he was a very strong developer of that particular idea. There we see wonderfully romantic flowing locks, sepia tinted and coloured up. This was the kind of figure he was. There's an example of the ontogeny recapitulates phylogeny that's in one of his works. Here he is in later life with a skull, a skeleton of what particular primate is that? I'm not sure. And I have a quote from him that's taken from Evans about capital punishment. Directly beneficial effect as a selection process by rendering incorrigible criminals harmless. You can't get more kind of like eugenic than that, really. Seems pretty cut and dried. He believed in sanity, the physical degeneracy of the brain held up human progress and had to be eliminated. So there we go, a little precursor of the T4 program, of the life unworthy of life. He believed as well that politics were applied biology. This is hardcore eugenics. And he even formed a league, the Monist League, to promote this particular program. But the story is a lot more complicated than that. Partly because the Monists themselves were pacifists. They did not like the First World War. They did not like war full stop. For exactly that reason that Hitler was exploring only too late in 1942, that it had a negative selection effect. So war eliminates the best and bravest. He wants to stop that. He wants to prevent that from happening. And so he was a pacifist
and his political organisation was as well. On top of which, having said all of those things, he wasn't very keen on that should be negative eugenics, not positive eugenics. He was very keen on positive eugenics, encouraging the right form of breeding. But he didn't like the idea that the state itself might take measures to implement eugenic programs. And as one historian quoted by Evans says, if Haeckel and the Monist League can be forerunners of Nazism, then so can most any other thinker or organisation. And the icing on the cake was that the Nazis removed Haeckel's books from libraries. So there again we see this very complex process. At each area that we've looked at, whether it's gender or eugenics, we see a story that is not a simple transfer of ideas from one person to another person, from one generation to another generation. We see the ideas being shaped by politics and culture. We see a very complex and patchy process that makes it extremely hard to generalise about social Darwinism in all sorts of different contexts. There is indeed a world of confusion about this, because as we've already seen, and to recap a bit of what we've said, social Darwinism could be many things to many people. One of the slides I missed out in the last lecture explored the attraction of eugenics to the left. Because of the Second World War, we forget the extent to which socialists and Fabians were deeply influenced by eugenic thought. When I stood up once and gave a talk about Lamarck and Darwin, I got attacked by a bunch of wobblies, IWW. It was quite ferocious. They did not like my vaguely social constructions interpretation of Darwin's theories. They were hardcore Darwinians. They were hardcore sociobiologists. And I could not figure out for the life of me why. But when I went away and read about the attraction of eugenics to the left, I could start seeing it. In fact, people like Haldane argue that, that eugenics was a good idea, but could only come into being if you created a society where all things were equal. And once all things were equal, there was a level playing field for everybody. There wasn't a problem in sussing out the effects of inheritance. But while there was exploitation in the world, while power was on the side of the bourgeoisie and the capitalists, you couldn't spot this because you couldn't define what was created by social and cultural difference and what was created by biological difference. So it appealed to Marxists and capitalists. We've even seen elements of the descent of man being taken by some feminists and turned to their advantage, despite the fact that there was not a lot of solace in the original text to feminists. Basically, it's got something to offer everyone. Now, eugenics combined with theories of racial struggle were a coherent strand of social Darwinism, and there can be no doubt that this strand had infected Germany from the late 19th century, and that the German leaders prior to the Great War themselves believed that they were involved in a great Darwinian struggle. It actually comes out during the war when the American journalist Vernon Kellogg spends time at the high command in Germany, and he listens to their discussions at night time over a few beers or a few more beers or whatever it was they were drinking, the fine wines that they pilfered from the vineyards of northern France. And he listened to them talking, and he picked out the social Darwinian strand. And we'll see this later on, published a book. Everyone in America was horrified, and it then gets used by creationists as a tool to beat Darwin around the head with. But we'll be looking at that when we look at the Scopes monkey trial in detail. So they were imbued with this idea, and it carried over into the post-war period. But I'd still say, without the political situation, without the way that the First World War panned out, without Versailles, without the constitutional settlement, without the polarisation in German society that occurred during this period, it would have been far more difficult for these ideas to take such a hold that the majority of German society was going to go along with elements of it. Having said that, I don't think very many Germans in Germany knew about the final solution. The Nazis were very, very careful to ensure that the extermination camps were all outside of German territory in places like Poland. Okay, it was a very, very careful decision because there is some evidence that, or quite a lot of evidence, that the German people would have found this very, very hard to take. So even there's levels of complexity. Well, let's now turn to Richard Weikart and think about Darwin, social Darwinism, and the moral order. The extent to which a materialist scientific theory that negates or gets rid of the need for God, what does it do to our moral systems? Does it undermine morality by removing one of the things that can be seen to be trying to enforce a moral code? And it's worth, before we go on and examine the biography of Weikart, to look at a few of his quotes. Here he's talking about Darwinism and death. Many leading Darwinian biologists and popularizers in the late 19th and early 20th centuries led the attack on existing moral standards, on body-soul dualism, and on the sanctity of human life. Darwinian biologists, popularizers, attacking the sanctity of human life. The Darwinian devaluing of human life may help explain why so many physicians, scientists, and other Germans cooperated with the Nazis. This is him continuing. Only in Germany did this Darwinian devaluing of human life produce an active euthanasia program. It occurred in Germany because a radical adherent of a naturalistic Darwinian worldview gained the reins of power and, together with the support of sympathetic physicians, could override the scruples of those upholding the value of every individual life. So, basically, we see the nut of his argument here, that circumstances in Germany led to the combination of social Darwinism to pervert ethical standards about the value of human life. And in effect, that social Darwinism, or Darwinism as he calls it, very rarely calls it social Darwinism, Darwinism, has this potential to undermine the moral order. Right, so who is this guy? Well, we know he's a professor of history at California State University. So he's in a history department. He's paid for teaching and writing about history. And no one sacked him. Okay, like many people, he did his undergraduate and then master's at a Christian university, so he comes from a Christian background. PhD at Iowa, that's not so indicative of anything in particular, and the author of countless articles and two books on social Darwinism and totalitarianism. And then the adherent of the thesis, materialism has undermined social order, and a fellow of the Discovery Institute. Some of you will know what the Discovery Institute is, and some of you won't. But to paraphrase what is going on here, they are an organization to promote intelligent design and the neoliberal program of economic individualism. So they come straight out of the right of politics and culture. Their program is designed to promote theorists that support intelligent design and attack the materialistic undermining of what they perceive to be right moral values, and also to defend and promote the sanctity of the free market. Hardly an organization that is disinterested. The point of view Discovery brings to its work includes a belief in God-given reason and the permanency of human nature. Now think about that. human nature, important words. Because if you're a good Darwinian, you will see your human nature as being evolved. Not permanent, not God-given. Okay, so it's saying something explicitly theological, and it's an explicit attack upon Darwinian thinking. And then there's a lot of stuff about American international leadership, voluntarism, personal liberty, balance with responsibility, blah-de-blah. You can go and follow the links. And Weikart has been a fellow of this organisation for a long time, so we can see where his interests lie. At the very least, he's aligning himself with an organisation that promotes intelligent design, will even allow Young Earth Christianity on its website, and is fundamentally opposed to important elements of Darwinian thinking. So any surprise that he starts writing books that explore the links between social Darwinism and Nazism and conclude about the way that Darwinism has perverted the moral order. And then I think as well, in looking at the way that people have reacted to this, it's also worth looking at the kind of things that are said on Wikipedia. You can see the biography here, people are throwing it together. And the thing that most interests me here is Weikart's best known for From Darwin to Hitler, Discovery Institute, Intelligent Design, crucial funding for the book's research. The academic community has been widely critical of the book. Okay, that is a statement. It is saying the academic community has rejected Weikart's ideas. And it's suggesting as well, underneath it, that they've rejected them because of the interests he has in intelligent design and all of that. Now, I would maintain that it's a lot more complicated than that. And if you follow up some of the references there, you will see that the reviews aren't all widely critical. That the review in ISIS is lukewarm, but generally what they would call generally positive. One of my least favorite wiki expressions came out to generally positive reviews. I think the most interesting case is what Richard Evans did and said. Richard Evans, a historian whose credentials are impeccable in this area, a man who fought against the right in a court case, wrote a huge report that demolished David Irving, the right-wing historian's assertion that in effect the Holocaust was a fabrication, established that David Irving was a Holocaust denier, was responsible for all of that. What he knows about Germany at this period, what he doesn't know, is probably not worth knowing. Sorry, I've better go back to the laptop there. What he doesn't know about Germany isn't actually worth knowing, probably. And he wrote the back blurb for Weikart's book. And the back blurb is extremely complimentary. He's read the book and he thinks it's a good book. He's not a Christian. He believes in evolution. He's from the left, and he's read the book, and he thinks it's a good book, and has come under attack for it. Now, I got intrigued by this, so I emailed him a couple of years back, and he emailed me back almost straight away, which was really interesting. And this was what he said. The fact he is an intelligent designer and funded by the Discovery Institute does not of itself invalidate his work. There's a lot of good detailed scholarship there. So I guess what I'm saying to you is that sometimes we have to go beyond the interest and weigh these cases up. That actually, just because his views are unpalatable to us in his religious and moral life, it might not be unpalatable to all of you. There's elements of it that are great. It's good to believe in a strong moral universe where people treat each other right. Okay? So we have to be very, very, very careful about just saying intelligent design, bad history, which is what went on that wiki site. Nevertheless, it does, he then makes the counterpoint that, for example, Robert Richards' biography of Hegel is a complete and utter whitewash, and no one gets on to him about that because he's a straight down the line Darwinian. Okay, it's time to wrap up. You can look at the headlines yourself, but you should be aware now that the debates are extremely complex, and you're not going to simply find the solution by saying intelligent design or Darwinian, therefore their ideas are right. We have to be critical about what we read, and that extends to giving people like Leichhardt the benefit of the doubt.